Did any of the following actually happen as described in these scary stories? I saw a man chasing a dogman. Dear Scary Stories NYC, I had a strange experience with my fiance when we were camping in Buckhorn State Park about a month ago. We've been taking every chance we can to get away from civilization in 2020 for some reason, I forget exactly why. But sometimes nature can be as hectic as the city. That's a lesson which was taught to us by the Dogman. Buckhorn State Park is really beautiful, especially in the late summer and early fall, and we were both extremely happy to get to be there. It's been very hard for us to find any privacy at all with everyone in both our families working at home all at once in the same two homes. But, you know, we have work, so we have nothing to complain about, we know that. Still, the idea of being completely alone, not having to wear germ-covered, disease-carrying cloth over our mouths and noses for three straight days, had us both feeling like human beings again. Do you remember that feeling? We were camping a bit away from most of the other campers for obvious reasons, and we knew that we were taking a risk by doing so. The more alone you are in the wilderness, the less chance you have of surviving an attack by predators like bears or wolves or big cats. We weren't thinking about werewolves, but we were prepared with bear spray and some other defenses. We had educated ourselves about all kinds of animals, but we neglected to read up on the mythical ones. The reason for our caution is that we're not really very talented or experienced at camping, and that area is really close by to other large natural preserves. You really don't know what might be wandering through, even animals that aren't officially supposed to be there. We only started camping this year, so we have had very little experience, but my one Yule Gibbons nature freak uncle got on Skype or Zoom or something with us back before our first adventure and taught us a lot. He also taught us what else we should study. So we had our share of book learning, and we had Wi-Fi within walking distance if we needed to look something up. My uncle warned us that on one side of the park we'd be staying in, there was Buckhorn Barrens State Natural Area, with both Yellow River State Wildlife Area and Yellow River Oxbows State Natural Area on the other side. Then, if you take a boat over the Wisconsin River or Castle Rock Lake, it won't be long until you find the Solberg Silver Lake State Natural Area. There are a lot of wetlands, or there is a lot of wetlands, I'm not sure of the grammar on that one. There's a lot of mud, basically. But there are beautiful areas you can camp in, and that was what we were doing. Now, what we saw should have been visible, as far as we can tell, to the campers on the edge of the main camping area, which we could just see through trees at the more secluded place that we were camping. We wanted to be far enough away that nobody would hear us talking, but close enough that somebody would hear us scream if something bad went down. So there was a kind of a ring of trees separating us from the main campsite and this clearing in the middle. We were on the opposite far side, so we could view the clearing on our left and the small patch of woods separating us from the campgrounds in front of us and on our right. Suddenly, to our far left, out of the trees, burst the damnedest thing I ever saw. It was huge and gray, and at first, I thought it was some kind of very tall silverback gorilla. It ran far too upright out of those woods, standing up tall like a man as he ran on relatively small feet and strange-looking legs. Confused, my eyes moved up to see a huge, hairy, muscular chest and arms as long as a gorilla's, flailing like a human runner's arms would when running for speed over short distances. He was going so fast that I almost didn't get a look at the strangest head any man or gorilla ever possessed. This thing had a wolf's head, even though it ran upright. In that last instant before it tore into the woods leading toward the campgrounds, I saw the eyes of the creature. They must have been completely dilated, as they shone a bright yellowish orange in the night. Maybe it was the reflection of our campfire. It had great fear, possibly even panic, in those wide open canine eyes. My feelings shifted from shock and surprise to fear and deep dread when I realized that dog-headed ape man was running from something. Since this was a scary moment at the time that it happened, my mind told me a joke to lighten the mood. It was a riddle, actually. It asked me, "What's scarier than a werewolf running past your tent at night?" And of course the answer is, whatever that werewolf is running from. I literally dove into our tent like a kid hiding under the covers, and I peeked out. I don't know what I expected, because my Yule Gibbons uncle had not informed me as to what the natural enemies of the North American werewolf are. My fiancé remained rooted on her spot, sitting with the fire to her back outside the tent, while I cowered inside, wondering if I was going to see Thanos or something come chasing that dog man. Well, we did get to see what was chasing the werewolf, but it seemed a bit anticlimactic at the time. It wasn't a Bigfoot, or another dog man, or an elephant, or a dinosaur. It was just this guy. There was a man, about half the size of the werewolf, and he had a coat on, like Humphrey Bogart used to wear, and some kind of an old-fashioned hat, too. He wasn't the hat man or a shadow man. He was a real guy in three dimensions like us, and he was running as fast as he could after that big dog-headed thing. I had thought that the dog man was about my size and I'm 6 feet, but we were viewing him from a distance in the night. When that man came after him, I could see that the werewolf must have been larger than I initially thought. If that man was 6 feet tall, then the dog man might have been 11 or 12. Maybe it was a very short man, I don't know. So the werewolf man ran left to right into the woods and seemed to come out on the side of the campgrounds. He ran along the wood line or just inside it, and we didn't hear anyone screaming or shouting over there, so maybe nobody noticed him. It's also possible that he ran inside the wood line and they couldn't see. We couldn't really tell well enough from where we were. We could hear both of them running, the dog man and the man, and sometimes we could make out their silhouettes briefly. Eventually, they disappeared far off to our right, and they didn't come back. We didn't know that they weren't going to come back, though, so we were on edge the rest of that night. We were about as romantic as we would have been at home. That dog man is a mood wrecker. So, I want to know, is this a thing? Why was the dog man afraid of that guy? I didn't see the guy carrying a weapon, but it was far off and at night, as I've said before. There was a bright moon out, but there are limits to moonlight. I had to block out the light of our fire to see anything at all. But even if he had a small weapon with him, why would the dogman's eyes have been lit up with fear that way? Are there men in trench coats out there capturing dogmen? Can anyone clue me or my fiancé in on what this was all about? We can't have been the only ones to ever see this guy. Maybe someone from the campgrounds is watching this and can write in to add more info? Has anyone else seen this Dick Tracy-looking guy that chases after the dog man? My girlfriend saw the dog head on the thing before she noticed the broad shoulders and the man-like chest. She didn't remember anything about the legs. I'm not sure she got down that far. But she also told me that she noticed the upright dog was terrified of whoever that guy was that was chasing him. I find her corroboration vital because she saw the face first, while I was still looking at the legs and trying to understand what kind of animal it was. I don't think we imagined that fear in its eyes, but I don't understand How that one little man could have freaked out the giant werewolf in that way. I guess there must be a really big puzzle piece, or maybe two or three or five puzzle pieces, still missing. I suppose we shouldn't say for sure that the Dogman was afraid of that human, since we didn't ask him if he was. Maybe the two were best friends and superheroes, and they were both racing off to thwart a bank robbery. I should leave my and my fiancé's opinions out of it, though, and just stick to the pure, hard facts. And in that case, all I can say for sure is, I saw a man chasing a dog man. Don't go anywhere. We've got another Dogman story in a second, but first I'd like to send a shout out to this episode's executive producer, Christina Gonzalez. Our EP is named Christina, as graceful as a ballerina, more fun than visiting Catalina, more hydro boost than Neutrogena. Please join us in thanking tonight's executive producer, Christina Gonzalez, for making tonight's episode possible with her kind donation. Ms. Gonzalez is the newest member of our PayPal subscribers club over at peterbernard.com, and that means tomorrow night, she gets to see the debut of our 10-hour secret uncensored Dogman special. Each Sunday night, we put out another Dogman story too wild to ever run on this channel. Any member of our PayPal subscribers or channel members here on YouTube can see those each Sunday night. Well, now we've got over 10 hours collected into one video, and it's going to be available tomorrow for viewing to channel members at the $3 level and above. If you joined at 99 cents or $1.50 or $2, then you can still see the weekly short episodes, but the mammoth new 10-hour collection is for the $3, $7, and $10 levels only. You can join today at peterbernard.com or by clicking the join link under this video. You don't need to join both. Joining either one accomplishes the same thing. And speaking of accomplishing something, it's about time we accomplished our second scary Dogman story of the episode, which we call, Can a Ouija Board Make Dogman Appear? Dear Scary Stories NYC, when I was a kid, I had a Dogman that would come and look in my window at night. He looked a lot like your Dogman, the one that you use in your thumbnails, the gray one. When you show a tight close-up of the nose and snout of that animal in your imagery, it brings back the scariest memories of my childhood. I remember the snout having that same peculiar quality that the one in your pictures has, except in real life, it would steam up my window as it breathed out. Then the window would clear, and it would breathe out again, and it would clear away. This Dogman I recognized as a werewolf, mainly because of the expression on its face, which was similar to an expression Lon Chaney would make in those old movies. His lower fangs were sticking up over the lips of its upper snout. Although the skull was nearly wolf-shaped, it was just human enough that he reminded me of Chaney with those upward-facing fangs on his lower jaw. The creature just watched me and stood nearly perfectly still. If not for the windows rhythmically fogging up and then clearing, I might have thought it was a life-size werewolf dummy placed outside my window to scare me. I would never remember when the creature left, and I'm certain that I have repressed memories. I don't know that hypnotism is the way to get at those memories, though, so they remain suppressed and hidden to this day. I remember waking up to see it there, and I remember us watching each other. And that's it. This is why my parents told me it was a dream. But I think that Dogman and I had further interaction that I was made to forget about. Wow, that sounded crazy, but, you know, I really mean it. I feel deep in my gut that there is more to this story than what I can remember now that I'm an adult. The horrible feeling I get in my belly each time I see that gray Dogman in your videos and thumbnails tells me that there was something else about those visitations something even worse than what I can remember. The Dogman didn't visit me every night, but often enough that my guidance counselor at school sent a note home to my parents that I needed to get more sleep. At the time, I felt guilty about all of this. Partially that was due to sleep deprivation, and partially it was due to the fact that I knew what was causing the werewolf to appear. At least, back then, I was certain about it. Now I don't know what to think. I was convinced that the Dogman was visiting me at night, because I had invited him to one time, when my sister and I were playing with her Ouija board. I'd been told in adulthood that neither Dogman nor Ouija boards work that way, so I'm curious if you or anyone in your audience have opinions about that subject. Here's what happened. We were playing with the Ouija board one afternoon, which was made by Parker Brothers and marketed as a game similar to Monopoly or Parcheesi. Sometimes we would try to use it and nothing at all would happen. Other times we would ask questions of spirits who didn't seem to be able to spell anything in English. It would go to random numbers and letters until we'd grow bored and put it away. Still, after a certain amount of time away from the Ouija board, my sister and I would always end up going back and giving the spirit board another chance. On this day, we encountered a spirit who would move the planchette to know when we would ask what its name was. We guessed that it didn't have a name, and we eventually learned via yes or no questions that it was not human. We asked a list of animal names, and each time it said no, it was not one of them. Not a rabbit. Not a walrus. Not an armadillo. Not a Bigfoot. When we asked if it was a dog, it started rushing toward yes and then stopped halfway there and milled back and forth as though confused. I had wanted a dog, and my mother always had an excuse why I couldn't get one. I told that no-name spirit that if it was really a dog, it was invited to come stay with me. A ghost dog was better than no dog, I joked around. But what if it wasn't taken as a joke by the spirit? And what if that spirit can manifest as the Dogman? The same creepy-looking gray and black Dogman type that you always show in your episodes. What if it's not a normal kind of animal, but some kind of forest spirit? What if it's a kind of intelligence that I contacted? And what if it was there at nights, fogging up my window, because I had invited it? Are there theories about werewolves or dogmen being forest spirits or god forms or Jungian archetypes? Forgive me, I'm talking over my head here, and I'm not really certain what I mean. I know that the creature outside my bedroom window at night seemed more than a normal creature. It seemed like something that should not have really been able to be there. And yet, at the same time, a window fogging up on a chilly night because of something breathing on it means that something has lungs, which it uses to humidify and heat up that air. Occam's razor says it must be a living creature that existed in real space and time on the other side of that glass. Figments of our imagination don't fog up the window. I just had a flash memory of the thing waking me up one night. I heard a tapping, and before I opened my eyes, I saw in my mind's eye the long claw of the werewolf tapping on the window from the outside. I opened my eyes, and it was there, exactly as I knew it was going to be, doing exactly what I already knew it was doing. There was something about that which was abnormal. I shouldn't have been able to see it before I opened my eyes, but I did. At least in the sense that I knew exactly what it was doing. That same sound could have been made any number of other ways by any number of other things or animals, but I knew it was a mythological creature. And then I opened my eyes and saw it. No wonder my parents thought these were dreams. But my sister didn't. Although she never saw the Dogman, she lived in fear of it. She knew why it was haunting me. And she wouldn't come into my room after dark because of the Dogman. She would listen to me tell her stories about the creature visiting me, and she would make me show her exactly where I saw it. We both went out and looked at the ground outside my window, but we didn't see any evidence like footprints or werewolf fur. Still, my sister did not doubt me for one second, and she told me I should go on the Ouija board and uninvite that big nameless dog thing. I didn't have the heart to do that. My parents got sick of both of us talking about the Dogman all the time, so they moved my bedroom up to the second floor of the house. I hated it. I was near their bedroom, and we couldn't get loud without hearing each other. But still, there were no more visits from the Dogman once I was up off the ground floor. I got better sleep again. I got better grades at school. I got a serious girlfriend. It was worth the trade-off. I feel a bit guilty that I had to abandon the Dogman after I guess I had invited it, via the Ouija, to come visit or stay. But I was a growing young man, and it was unhealthy for me to continue along in that manner. Still, though, one question continues to nag at me all these years later. And that question is, can a Ouija board make Dogman appear?
Thanks for watching till the end. If you liked what you saw, please consider clicking like on the video or sharing it. You can become a channel member by clicking the join link below. Then you can check our community page to find the links to 10 hours or more of secret, uncensored Dogman stories too wild to be told on this channel. Your other option is to join our paid subscribers club at peterbernard.com. That's Peter's homemade club, where he will personally email you the links as well as occasional secret club messages. You may also be included as an executive producer in a future episode. You have a scary experience you want to tell us about? You can email us at scarystoriesnyc@gmail.com or else call our Scary Stories voicemail hotline at 804-LESS-SCARY. The machine cuts off every few minutes, so if you have a long story, please keep calling back and we'll piece it together later on. Good night and have a scary tomorrow.
Scary stories.